Morning. Welcome to the 19th meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee in 2015. Could everyone make sure that mobile phones and other electronic devices are silent and switched to airplane mode? Thank you. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session on employment support, which is part of the committee's inquiry into the future delivery of social security in Scotland. We're going to split this session into two parts, and the first panel will be employment support providers, and then the second part of the evidence session is a round table of organisations that support clients in employment projects. I'd like to welcome today Tanya Gilchrist, who's Head of Operations in Scotland for the Shaw Trust, which is a work choice contractor, Alistair Kerr, who's the Head of Quality and Contract Compliance, Momentum Scotland, which is also a work choice contractor. Paul de Pellette, who's the Director of Ingeus Work. Kate Still, who's the Co-Chair of Employment Support Scotland. And Nicholas Young, who's the Director of Working Links, a work programme prime contractor. Would any of you like to make an opening contribution to the committee before we go into a question session?
Can Kate? I just, yeah, if you don't mind. So I'm Kate Still. I'm from Employment Support Scotland. I'm the co-chair along with Laurie Russell. Just to give you background to that organisation, it represents the provider base in Scotland. That's the private sector, third sector, voluntary sector, public sector. It's, you know, involving a real broad church. And I should also note that in my day job, I work for Rathbone, which is a youth charity, and we're involved obviously in the Employment Support Scotland because we offer services in terms of skills and employment. I think just to say that we think that this is a great opportunity to respond to the questions of the committee and to explain what we think might be important to committee members thinking about the future and the opportunity that the devolution of the programmes offer to the Scotland and a Scotland solution. So that's really just from that point of view, I wanted to make those points clear.
Okay, anyone else? Nicholas? Yep.
Hi, just a very quick introduction to those of you that are not familiar with Working Links. We're a public-private voluntary sector organisation that have been supporting long-term unemployed in Scotland for 15 years. I've done that through a range of contracts from small community-based programmes right through to the current work programme that we deliver through six key partners, two from the third sector, two local authorities and two private sector partners.
Okay, there we go.
A very quick bit of background. We deliver the work programme across Scotland and also across a number of areas in England. We've been operating in Scotland for 8 years, and in that time we've helped support 44,000 people who are on long-term unemployment benefits and health and disability benefits into work. And like Working Links, we deliver the work programme in partnership with a range of other organisations from the private and voluntary sectors across Scotland.
Okay, thank you. No one else? Okay. Last week, I don't know if any of you were able to either read the witness contribution last week or watch it, but we heard from our witnesses last week that one of the features that they had to contend with was essentially cold calling, where people who were trying to get back into work were told that they had to contact a number of companies to determine whether there were any vacancies. Now, it did strike me at the time that if they weren't being given a list of vacancies to inquire about, then if they're phoning small companies in their area and there are other unemployed people from that area being told to do the same thing, then it actually could become real nuisance phone calls for some of the companies in the area, with a whole succession of unemployed people phoning them up to inquire about non-existent vacancies, because that was a requirement of what they had to do as part of the work programme. Would any of you like to comment on that?
Can I'll pick that up. I actually had the pleasure of sitting in the evidence session last week, and I didn't quite recognise the way that that was presented. I think that it was Jake that had suggested that she was asked to cold call between 9 and 5. It's certainly not a feature, has been a feature, nor will be a feature of how we approach employers. We have a very, very robust employer engagement strategy, and cold calling does not play a part of that.
For either you or any of the other contractors, if anyone is on the programme, they will not be asked to phone employers to ascertain or to ask if there are any vacancies. They will only be directed to where there are vacancies.
Certainly not in the manner that it was suggested last week. We will have a range of approaches, and speculative approaches are to be encouraged, particularly when someone has been supported to the point where they are able to speak to local employers, but it would be a very targeted approach that we would support them on.
So
not cold speculative way that was suggested last week.
So speculative calls are to be encouraged, but not cold speculative calls. No. But what's the difference?
Well, they would be targeted at areas that, and employers that the individual had suggested, and we'd work with our employer team to identify, and then we would either work with them or get them to the point where they were engaged enough to make those calls on their own.
So
but it's a very, very small proportion of our employer engagement strategy.
So if you're unemployed in the East End of Glasgow, where there is significant unemployment and there are not many large employers left, so you've got to rely on either city centre jobs or some of the you know, small companies or else jobs in the retail park, you're effectively all chasing the same small number of vacancies. How do you then filter that out so that the time of that individual who is looking for a job is used productively and is not merely almost like a challenge or a test to them that you will have to call in order to prove that you're really looking for work?
That's, oh, sorry, Paul. Please,
can I maybe pick that up? Yeah, so. I mean, I suppose without being entirely obvious, I think when you're out of work and you've been out of work for a very long period of time, which is the case for everyone that's on the work programme, then the task of getting back into work and rebuilding your confidence and your skills is not an easy one. And there's a wide range of different support that needs to be available to people to recognise the fact that people have different attributes and different skills. We do have some cold calling as part of our service offering. We have one of our 30-odd workshops that we have available for people to choose to go on. Is to spend an hour and a half being trained on what you would do if you were going to take that up. So how would you go about doing it? How would you identify employers that may be useful for that? And there would then be an hour and a half practical session. But that's one of 30-odd things that we make available to people if they choose to do it. And that also includes things like embracing change, interview skills, preparing for group-based assessments. It will be suitable for some people and not suitable for others, but it represents a fairly small proportion of the overall things that people do on the work programme. And it also operates hand in hand with a huge range of other methods of identifying jobs. The days of jobs being advertised are sadly long gone. Less than 30% of jobs that we find for our clients and that they find for themselves are actually advertised in any way at all. So a lot of the work we do is to work in partnership with local and national employers to encourage them and convince them that we have the ability to support them to get staff that help them to build and grow their businesses.
Okay, so the cold calling aspect is not suitable for everyone. Does that mean that not everyone is asked to do cold calling? Okay, and the employers that they are calling, do you follow up to see whether the employers object to having a succession of calls in from, you know, a number of individuals, particularly if it's a, you know, a medium, small to medium-sized company that's maybe already stretched in its own capacity?
Well, I think the feedback that we get is that actually quite often people pick up leads through doing things like that, particularly with small to medium-sized companies that don't always have the time or the money to go and actively recruit. As I said, it doesn't form a big part of what we do. No. We would probably run, you know, one or two sessions every few weeks. And people, the benefit of doing it is partly about identifying the vacancies, but also, I think, as someone from the committee picked up last week when you were talking about doing cold calling from a political perspective, when it goes well, it can feel really good. It's something that actually builds people's confidence and can empower them. And it's, that's partly what we also look to get for from that experience. But to assure you of the, you know, of the kind of 70-odd thousand clients that have started work as a result of the work programme, a very small proportion would ever have done any cold calling.
But that wasn't the question I asked you. What I asked was, have you done any follow-up with those companies that are receiving the cold calls to see whether they're happy for that to continue?
Well, we don't do direct follow-up with those companies because essentially the individuals themselves would identify the companies that they were going to phone. We don't have a list of companies, as suggested last week, that people would kind of bash away and phone at. But what we also do is we have some kind of technological solutions whereby we identify all of the vacancies that are advertised on the thousands of job boards that are available, both at a local and at a national level, and use that to build a better and a more intelligent picture of what types of companies are recruiting and when. But there are also other things that we do. So if people want to work in retail, for instance, which a reasonable number of people do, then one of the best ways of getting a job in a retail environment is to actually just pop into shops. So we will have, you know, small groups of clients supported by one of our advisors who may kind of traipse up and down the local high street to identify whether anyone is recruiting. Being there at the right time can sometimes be very important. That's sometimes a very good way of equalising the odds for people who might otherwise feel that they're quite far away from work.
Do your staff work on the basis of targets?
Yes, they do.
What are those targets?
Well, there are many different types of targets that operate within our business, but I think fundamentally the target structure is about making sure that that the service and the contract is successful. So the targets can be anything from the proportion of their caseload that have a CV, the proportion of their caseload that have a forward appointment, so that we're encouraging them to actively work with everyone and to kind of, you know, to convince people to come in. It can also be about referrals to workshops and referrals to different types of interventions, and it is largely also about getting people into sustained work. You know, the point of the work programme, which I think does differentiate it from most of the employment programmes over the last 20 years, is to get people to a stage where they not only move into work, but that they stay in a job and stay in that job for 6 months. Okay. And that drives the behaviour, I think, of our advisors.
And what are your success rates in that?
Our success rates are very good in some cases and improving in others. We are exceeding all of the contractual measures are set by DWP for the work programme. And the point that's worth mentioning is that the work programme is the latest in a long line of programmes going back to the New Deals and the employment zones. And the targets for the work programme are essentially based on the best that any other programme has delivered in the past, with an additional uplift. So the fact that we're exceeding those targets suggests that we are doing well. But actually, as long as there are people who are not moving into work, we need to think about how we do more and do better.
Forgive my ignorance, but I don't know what very well means, so could you maybe help me to understand what
Well, I think probably there are as you would expect with any kind of government programme, there's external analysis and external audit of that. So the National Audit Office and the Work and Pensions Select Committee at Westminster recently noted that the work programme is performing at least as well, or if not better, than all previous programmes that have been commissioned by UK government, and it's doing that at a significantly reduced cost. There are 9 different payment groups in the work programme. There are 24 different performance measures, and therefore it's not easy to say that there's a single measure that the programme is measured on.
Yeah, but it would hardly be a ringing endorsement to say that it's doing better than previous programmes. You know, just help me to understand how successful you are. What are your success rates?
Well, the success rates, as I've said, are that the programme is exceeding its contractual measures. The contractual measures are based on the proportion of people from each of those 9 payment groups that at the end of the 2-year period are progressed into sustained work.
And do you publish any figures?
The figures are widely published by DWP via the National Audit Office. They're published every 3 months, and there is a significant amount of data that goes down to local ward level that will show everything from the number of people referred, the number of people attached, and that's those who join the programme, the number of people who achieve a job outcome at 6 months, and then those who continue to stay in employment for an additional 12 months after that. So there's a lot of data available.
Okay. Claire, and then Christina and Neil.
I think you've partially answered my questions from the convener. But that 70,000 you said that had been helped into work through the programme, is that a Scottish figure?
That's the figure in Scotland between both of these organisations, yes.
Yeah. And is that people who have exceeded the 12-month target or the 6-month sustained employment or who have just been able to get employment?
That's the total that have moved into work, entered a job.
Entered a job. Yep. So do we have figures about how many of those 70,000 are still in a job 6 months?
Well, what you have a kind of delay, obviously, in reporting, because essentially the way that the programme would be measured, it would look at the number of people referred, the number of people attached, and the number of people who've achieved a job outcome at that point in time. So the latest figures that were published by the National Audit Office, which were published up until the middle of this year, at that stage there were over 41,000 people who had achieved a job outcome, and that means being in a job and having stayed in that job for a minimum of 6 months, and that's something that's positively evidenced by proof from an employer, and also evidenced through off-benefit checks with HMRC.
Another question to make. One to a new topic, is that okay?
Well, I don't know, Christina, is it the same issue for you?
Yes. Yeah, okay. So on the same issue, and welcome to the committee this morning. Nice to see you again, Nicholas. I remember the visit to your organisation in Hamilton a while back now, actually. Just last week, you may have heard me quote some figures for the DWP, which I find absolutely astonishing. For an overall sum of £1.89 billion when the scheme started in 2011, the DWP figures up until March this year was that only 9% of sick and disabled people find employment lasting 3 months after 1 year taking part in the scheme. That the overall figure was only 24% of those going through the programme. And of those on ESA, those claimants, 4.3% of them finding a job, which is actually down since 2011, which was 7.1%. Could anybody explain that to me, please?
I can talk about the figures that we've had that have been the published figures. I'm pleased to say that they're in advance of the numbers that you suggested there. Of our ESA customers in Scotland, I think we've supported just over 2,000 into a job, and 1,485 of those have sustained a job outcome. So the 72% success rate of those that move into employment are able to remain in employment.
After a year?
It's after 6 months.
Okay, so 2,000, and then you said 1,400 staying in, so yeah. It's 40. So what percentage of that is the overall figure of people that you're working with?
The ESA group, the way that the contract has sort of changed, I think it's a very important point to note. In Scotland, initially, the programme was designed for about 70% job seekers, 30% ESA. The way that the contract has changed in recent times is that that's almost the inverse of that now, and there are more ESA customers coming through than there are job seekers allowance customers. A very important point to recognise the changing characteristics and the changing needs of customers as the programme has developed. Also really important to note the sort of change in scale of work programme from when it first started, from somewhere in the region of about 60,000 referred in the first year, right down to, I think we're probably expecting about 16,000 this year. So a very different change in both the nature of the individuals that require the support and the scale of them.
Okay, so how can you account for the ESA figure being 4.3% when in 2011 it was 7.1%?
I don't recognise those figures. I've only got our own figures, our own delivery figures.
These are the
figures
released by DWP.
Okay, but they're DWP's figures. They're,
okay,
they're
so
not
DWP's
our organisational
figures are different.
Figures.
So how do you report to DWP then? Because obviously they must report the figures that you report to them. So.
Figures are reported automatically through the system. I believe you're probably quoting the overall UK figures there. We can only report Working Links and Scotland figures here.
Okay. Has the contract changed? You said that there were slight changes in the contract. Has that changed over the years? You're now saying there's only 16,000 people, 16,000 too many in my opinion, but 16,000 people going through the system.
Yeah, the contract has changed, but I was specifically speaking about the nature and scale of the contract. It's much smaller than it was when it was initially started, and the characteristics of the individuals that are coming through for support has changed significantly. The different payment groups have changed quite a lot.
Okay, are you getting individuals who have got more complex needs?
Yes, absolutely. There's no doubt about that. Individuals that come to the work programme, as Paul rightly said, you know, they make up quite a small proportion of the overall cohort that become unemployed, of 100 people that present at Job Centre Plus today as being unemployed, less than 10% will find their way onto a programme like the Work Programme. So they've been unemployed for quite a considerable time. And as you would expect, the challenges that they come with don't sit in isolation. There are usually a range of multiple barriers. Key around those are sort of functional maths and English, educational qualifications, and a range of health conditions that all compete and usually mean that that individual is significantly far from the labour market at the point when they enter the work programme.
Yeah, so going back to that ESA group that I spoke about in my initial opening remarks, and I have seen the work that Working Links do in Hamilton, you know, I've seen the work that goes on there. Have you changed that? Have you adapted that? Have you made it more flexible to meet the more complex needs of some of the clients that are coming through the door?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we constantly change and evolve our delivery model and approach based on the needs of the individuals that we serve. So that's an absolute given. The programme has changed and refined and continuously improved since we started.
Okay.
We collect a huge amount of data, information on the customers that we serve, and I suppose what you do is you drill that down and analyse it to drive future performance. So the more that you learn about the needs of customers, the more you tailor your intervention to support those.
Okay, much profit have you made this year?
I don't have that figure in front of me. Roughly, I think maybe the last 3 years we've probably broken even, I think. If my accountant was here, he might well be able to tell me that.
Okay.
Okay, before I bring Neil Findlay, Kevin Stewart and John McAlpin in, are there any of the other members of the panel want to say anything at this stage about what we've been discussing?
Yeah, Tanya? I was just going to add in relation to your question, Convener, about cold calling and in response to some of the comments made by colleagues here. In short, Scotland have supported 3,500 disabled people into work in the last 4 or 5 years. And although cold calling is part of our learning experience, it isn't necessarily the be-all and end-all to actually finding work. But certainly, I suppose, in support to some of the comments and some of the questions that are being asked, when you're supporting someone who has numerous barriers to employment, to encourage them to become armed and dangerous, in a sense, in the employment field, it is important to allow people to experience the hardest experiences, which include cold calling. And I don't think anyone in this room would want to cold call an employer and say, have you got a job? It's an extremely difficult thing to do. But it does provide a learning experience for individuals. But I think from what I'm hearing, this is all about the people out there who need to find work. And I know we're talking about statistics and funds and so on, but certainly there seems to be an argument about a person-centred approach, offering a full range of support and delivery to the people that walk through the door, not just that one particular work stream.
Okay, thanks. Kate?
Just on that, touching the point made by Tanya, I think the ambition of all the providers is to provide that personalised support. Now, for some individuals, they may not have experienced that, and I take that from the committee, you know, evidence last week. But I think the ambition is to offer that to individuals, to give them the opportunity to try out new things that will really help them. And I think the characteristics have changed in terms of that ESA group. There are more complex issues that people are dealing with. They have been on programmes longer. There's some deep-rooted issues. And I think the opportunity going forward is to look at how we can bring in other resources, now that it's going to be devolved, other resources that can provide the type of wraparound and holistic support to those individuals around health and housing and debt. And whilst that's there within the work programme provider and work choices providers remit to work with partners, I think the fact that one set of programmes has been reserved and one set of programmes has been local, I think there's now this opportunity to integrate them far better going forward.
Okay. Neil Findlay?
I find that a bit odd that cold calling is deemed as a learning experience. I mean, whacking your thumb with a hammer very hard is a learning experience. It's not necessarily something you would choose to do again. I just find that a bit of a strange justification for it. But just back to the companies providing the service, you mentioned there's a target system. Is there a bonus system when you meet those targets for individuals who are working with individuals? So an advisor or whoever, do they get a target to meet and are paid part of their salary or a bonus based on meeting that target?
Not in our organisation, they don't know. I think, you know, I've worked in employability for 20-odd years in a number of different sectors, in the voluntary sector and in the private sector, and the reality is when you're trying to achieve a specific milestone, then the natural attraction is to think about having a target-based approach. But one of the really important things about creating a target-based approach is to think about what you want to incentivise and also to think about what some of the behaviours are that you don't want to incentivise. And you know, it's very important that you try and build a system that not only hits the target, but hits the point of the target. And if the point of the target is to be engaging with, you know, the maximum number of people possible, to be connecting them to the support they need, and to be getting as many as possible to a point where they move into work, then if you build your systems around that, then you can have quite effective target systems. But we don't go down the road of paying financial bonuses for our staff.
Yeah, we do have a bonus system, but it's built around sort of three pillars of, you know, performance, which is sort of metrics around the quality of the, and around the compliance that we need to ensure.
So if I was an advisor working for your business, and a frontline advisor working with clients, and I met my target, what would that mean for me financially?
It could mean a financial incentive. It varies at different quarters in the year. I would need to come back to you on that.
If you could provide the committee with that, that would be helpful. At the next level in both organisations, is there the same situation? So you've got the frontline advisor who does X, Y or Z, and in your organisation they don't get a financial reward. But something must happen if they do or don't meet that target, because why have it in the first place? So maybe you could explain that. And at the next level of management, and then the next level of more senior management, directors, whoever else, is there a, you know, system going up the chain where if their department, if their section, if their responsibility meets those targets, they get an award as well? Is that how the system works?
That's not, doesn't represent our organisation, that's not
so
how
we
work.
So there's no one in the, you know, the hierarchy of jobs receive a bonus based on the targets being met?
No.
Right. Okay, that's very helpful.
Can I talk about the other part of the question,
sorry,
if that's okay?
Sorry, yes,
so, you know, getting people who, you know, thrive and survive in an environment where you're delivering, you know, as Tanya said, kind of, you know, really good person-centred services to people who actually, in many cases, and this is definitely the case for the ESA group, haven't had support from previous programmes. And that's a really important point to make. There are two substantial customer groups in this programme that just were not supported in previous programmes prior to the work programme being put in place. It's a very difficult job to do. It takes kind of exceptional individuals to do that. We are lucky to have an incredibly good team of individuals, and we spend a lot of time and a lot of effort investing in those individuals and supporting them, giving them the skills they need to do the job, and also making sure that we have the right people in the right place at the right time. If people are struggling with particular aspects of that job, then we would have a support process that would kind of come into play at that point in time, which would be around providing additional support to that individual to identify what it is that they might be struggling with at that point in time, whether it's prioritisation of their workload, whether it's working with particular types of individuals, and we would use the collective skills and knowledge in that broader team to help support that individual. You know, there's a huge array of knowledge required, and it's actually quite difficult to deal with, you know, a broad group of individuals and know absolutely everything you need to know. So we have a culture of, well, the advisor might not always know the answer to that question, somebody nearby will, and, you know, we encourage people to kind of make use of that and make use of the local experts that exist in our sites.
Yeah, we have a range of incentive schemes to drive performance and to reward and recognise the contributions of our staff right throughout the organisation.
In terms of the figures, again, we're going back to that, that Inclusion Scotland and their evidence have said that the 5% of people go through successfully through the work programme, as opposed, and this is long-term sick and disabled people, as opposed to 24%. Success rate of all referrals. Are these figures you recognise? He says the job outcome rate for long-term sick and disabled people in the work programme is only 5%, approximately one-fifth of the success rate for all referrals. That's Inclusion Scotland's figures. If I was then to ask you to replace those figures with ones that you recognise, what would they be? Not yeah. thousands, not, you know, anything other than the percentages, so that we get the sort of same understanding.
Okay, well, for ourselves, for our ESA customer groups, the percentage that move into work is, at this stage, is 13%. Secure work.
Okay.
The contractor targets are set by DWP based on previous programmes, and in order to allow this contractor target to be measured, you need to allow the cohort the full 24 months on the programme and then a further up to 18 months in terms of being supported. But the measures that they have for the main customer groups, there are three main customer groups in the work programme that represent about 75% of the overall volumes that go through. The first is 18 to 24-year-olds, and the minimum performance expectation for that group is that 33% will achieve a job outcome, so move into a job and have stayed in that job for 6 months, and there will obviously be some people drop out during that period. For 25-plus clients, it's 27.5%, and for ESA claimants who have made a recent claim and are in the work-related activity group, that target is 18.5%. And for the last couple of years, the figures that DWP publish are showing that all providers are exceeding those targets now. The figures that you're talking about there, that Inclusion Scotland have quoted, would be from the very early stages of the work programme. And that's the individuals that have been right through the journey for those early months on the programme.
So do we now... I know you've broken it down into three categories. They've not. They haven't done that.
No, they haven't, no.
Right, so if we were to... And it's only for simplicity, no other reason... If we were to go and use the same methodology as they've applied, what would those two figures be?
It's slightly difficult to say without kind of misleading you, because the time periods and everything would depend quite a lot on that. What I can say to you now is that in this year of the work programme, the last year of the work programme, and the year before that in the work programme, for all of those custom groups, we are exceeding those contractual measures. So the 33%, the 27.5% and the 18.5%. That's what we measured on here and now on a day-to-day basis by the Department for Working Pensions.
You would contend that it's more than 5%, and the 24.7% of all referrals is more. You're more successful.
I would, yes, but I think, you know, in fairness to those figures, there's a long lag time in those figures. Mm-hmm. You know what you're talking about there is people who started the programme in 2011, and obviously we've kind of moved on quite a bit since then.
Okay, thanks,
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask Mr. De Pellette first if he watched last week's session or if he's read the official report?
I didn't watch the session. I read the transcript yesterday when it was published.
Okay. Did the transcript give you an idea about the two folks who were previously in the work programme, about what they were about?
It did give me an idea of what those individuals were about. I think that there were some things that they said that were familiar and some things that they said that I didn't recognise.
So what was familiar and what was not familiar to you?
Well, I mean, I do not want to get into talking about individual sets of circumstances, because I don't know either of those individuals and I haven't had the opportunity to talk to them myself. But what I can say more broadly is that I certainly didn't recognise people cold calling from 9 o'clock to 5 o'clock. That's not something I see when I walk through any of my offices, and it's not something that's a feature of what we do. You know, customer insight is something that, as Nick has alluded to, is incredibly important, not just from the point of view of knowing whether people are happy with the experience that they're getting, but also from the point of view of identifying the things that work well for certain individuals and essentially doing more of them. So, by way of example, one of the things that we've changed over the time on the work programme, bearing in mind that people are with us for 2 years, is that we now have a delivery model where people will essentially spend less time transitioning from one individual to another. One of the features of our delivery model is that we had people going from a particular employment advisor to a different type of support stream, perhaps with a different organisation.
Well, let me stop you there, because I think this is particularly important. All of this should be about building confidence and knocking down those multiple barriers.
Yeah.
And yet it seems that in the cases that we had heard from last week, and many of the cases that I've dealt with as a constituency MSP, that rather than build confidence and motivate folk, what we've seen is folks' confidence take a hit, and their motivation disappearing, and then being completely and utterly demotivated by the experience that they've gone through. What would you say to that?
Well, clearly, we do not want people to go through any of our programmes and not feel supported. And, you know, the one thing I would say is that while I didn't recognise what many of those individuals were saying last week, it also doesn't reflect what we hear and see on a day-to-day basis. You know, we have, I think you'll all acknowledge, we have extended invites to all of the committee to come and spend time in our offices and talk to our clients and talk to our staff and see firsthand what's being
done. I'll stop you there because we go on lots of visits and heard Ms. McKelvey there. But often on these visits, we don't see the true scenarios that are going on in offices on a day-to-day basis. And that always troubles me a little bit. But, you know, one of the things which was quite obvious from last week and quite obvious from the evidence that I've got from my own neck of the woods is that sometimes this works, and it's probably down to the personalities involved, including those advisers, but it seems that in the majority of cases, it does not. Now, we had two folk here last week. We had a number of other folk who could have come but felt too afraid to come. Would it be the case that some of the folks who are on the work programme at this moment in time would be too afraid to complain about the level of service that they were getting from yourselves or some of your competitors because they may face sanctioning if they complain too much?
No, that is not the case at all, for a few reasons. Firstly, we do not sanction people on the work
No, you
programme.
Don't.
No, but, we don't.
No, but the DWP does, and
Absolutely.
How much advice does the DWP take from yourselves?
Well, it's not a case of taking advice.
Let
me be very clear. If you're an employment advisor working on the work programme, one of the most important things to have is to build trust and rapport with the people that are coming through the door. And therefore, the sanction regime, in some regards, could be viewed as a disincentive for that, because the reality is that you want to build trust and rapport. You want to have people attending appointments. We will mandate people to do certain things, but in the vast majority of cases, that's to attend an appointment. People are given due notice to attend an appointment. If they want to change that appointment, they are able to do that. It's not in any advisor's interest to be sitting there and waiting for a client to show up for an appointment and for them not to show up.
Well, I think trust and rapport would be a great thing to have, but from what we heard last week and from experiences of myself and colleagues, what we actually have is fear. Mr. Young, you were in the back of the room last week listening to what was said. Does the evidence that the two ladies gave last week reflect what your knowledge of your business is?
I think it certainly reflected their experience of it, and I think it's important to acknowledge that I think it was Donna that had been with ourselves on that, and she said one relationship with an advisor was not what she was expecting, not what she got, and we're disappointed at that. On the other hand, she said the next advisor she got couldn't have been any more helpful, and she got an excellent relationship with her, and they helped her progress to where she wanted to be. And I think that's the type of relationship that characterises and reflects the experience that we have. It's certainly what comes through from our customer service surveys, both our internal ones and the independent ones that we get collated every 6 months, where levels of satisfaction are very high. I think last week it was really disappointing to hear if anyone doesn't have a positive experience from it. But the reality is, and what we see from tens of thousands of different experiences, is that in the vast majority of cases, customers are very satisfied with the support that they're getting.
Are people afraid to complain?
Not that I'm aware of. We do an independent survey where 1,000 customers are spoken to by an independent organisation.
But, you know, we're talking about folks who often are deeply suspicious. Do you think that they think it's an independent survey?
I can't speak on behalf of them. I'm sure it's pointed out to them quite clearly that there is an independent survey.
You were unable to answer a question about profitability earlier. Can you give us an idea of how much the work programme contract that you have is worth to Working Links in Scotland? What's the value of that contract?
Well, there's a contract value, which is what you bid for, but then there's how much it will cost is based on how you deliver that, so that varies.
Just tell me the contract value.
I think I believe it's about 160 million, 167 million pounds.
So you're getting 167 million pounds from the DWP to deliver this service?
That's the total contract value. Okay. How much we realise of that will be dependent on how well we deliver it.
You've already told us, so you don't know what the profitability is either. So, and Ingeus, how much is the DWP contract for Scotland worth to Ingeus, please, Mr. de Pellette?
Well, the situation will be fairly similar because we're delivering half of the contract and Working Links are delivering half of the contract, and that's over a nine-year period.
£167 million?
Over a nine-year period.
Over a nine-year period?
Yep.
And you have no idea of profitability on that for your organisation?
Well, to be perfectly honest, you will need to look at the profitability at the end of that nine-year period. It's a payment by results programme. We get paid when we move people into work and keep them there for 6 months. There will be a reasonable number of individuals that we spend a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of money on, and we do so gladly, that we may not get paid for, but that's the nature of performance payment by results contracts.
And that payment by results contract, does that often lead to situations where folk are put into employment which you know is going to be absolutely, completely and utterly unsuitable for them in order for you to realise the payment from the DWP?
No, it doesn't at all. And I think if you look at the dynamic of actually getting someone into a job that lasts for 6 months, if you think about the day-to-day process of getting someone to a stage where they're ready to move into a job and to keep them there for 6 months, it's simply not the case that you can kind of, you know, somehow coerce people and put them in jobs. And in fact, we, because of the reluctance of the committee to come and see us, we hired an independent company to do some focus groups with our clients, and one of the features that came through from that was that people said that they felt that we were genuinely interested in getting them the right job for them, not just any job.
Final question, convener. Obviously, vast swathes of this is to be devolved, but vast swathes is to be retained, including programmes like Access for Work. The sanctions regime, of course, is also going to remain reserved. Do you think it is wise to devolve the bulk of the work programme but leave the sanctioning element of it with the Department of Works and Pensions? We'll start with Ms. Gilchrist first, please.
I certainly think it's going to cause some confusion. I think we're already talking here about people who are dissatisfied with current service delivery. That they are making noises, obviously, from last week about what their needs might be, that they probably need support and so on. And to have a reserved and devolved rules potentially affecting the people that we're talking about could ultimately cause confusion and again, I think, more dissatisfaction.
Confusion, lack of cohesion.
Yep.
Bit nonsensical.
In your view.
I was hoping for yours. Mr. Kerr.
Yep, I think I agree with what Tanya says. I think any performance contracts have to have elements of conditionality attached to them. But if that's to the detriment of probably the most vulnerable across the UK, then surely that should not be a model that's adopted by the Scottish Government.
Ms. Still?
Employment Support Scotland and ERSA was really clear in this. We actually advocated for the devolution of Job Centre Plus and all levers, if you like, related to this in Scotland because we think it would work better. Given the fact that that's not the position of the UK government in terms of Smith Commission response, what we want to do is to work with the Scottish government to ensure that the impact of the sanctions regime is mitigated so that the impact on individuals is not an impact of fear and concern and distress. What we want to have is an impact that actually supports those individuals. And taking the point that...
So what kind of things need to be put in place to deal with that, then?
Well, I think it's something, it's a discussion, it's an ongoing discussion with the provider network because we are working to the guidelines of the work programme, the guidelines set down by DWP in terms of work choices. And I think going forward in the new commissioning and procurement process, if we're looking at things that we can do to mitigate that. We can't, obviously, sanctions, conditionality is still a reserved power. But what we can do is look at how we implement that and ameliorate that so that the impact on individuals is lessened. Because it was distressing to read the transcript for those individuals, but I do believe that that is, not the case for the majority of individuals going through the programmes because the staff that I meet on a daily basis came into the industry because they actually do want to help individuals, the vast majority of the staff.
But that lack of cohesion, the fact that that element is being reserved, that illogicality of that actually leads to more confusion, does it not?
I don't disagree. I think it was stated the position.
Thank you. Mr. Young, please.
Yeah, I guess so. I'm more interested in what powers that we have and how can we make the most of those powers that are coming across. I think it's important to put work programme, work choice and any other DWP provision in a little bit of context in Scotland. Overall, I think it equates to about 10% of the overall spend on employment and skills in Scotland. I'm really interested in how we get the whole system to be as integrated as possible. I think we have a fantastic opportunity with the addition of new powers. What we need to do is to take the evidence base of what's worked well, take the lessons from what could be done better, and then build that into the design process and then the commissioning of future services.
You could have the most amazing service ever, bells and whistles, the entire shebang, the personalisation that we all want, and yet the DWP at the end of the day will decide whether somebody is to be sanctioned or not. Is that right?
That's for DWP to decide. It's not for Working Links.
Well, I'll be very happy if we do end up in a situation where we have that programme you described.
Will that not cause problems for those folks who are delivering the service, where you know you're dealing with one agency, whatever that may be in Scottish terms, and then the DWP comes along and says, well, no, that's not right, this person is going to be sanctioned. Does that not cause your organisation some difficulty as well in that regard?
I think we'd find a way to work alongside whoever had responsibility for the various powers.
As long as there was money in it?
No, as long as it was providing the service that we felt was valuable.
Mr. de Pellette.
Well, just picking up on a couple of those points there, where you've got any crossover from one organisation to another or one authority to another, then there's the danger that there won't be a seamless approach. And actually, if we're really honest, that happens quite a lot with stuff that we already control. We do have an opportunity to line that up better going forward. But to go back to your point around what changes could be made, one simple change that often comes up when I talk to employment advisers is that if they had the ability to give a good cause, then that would make life much easier. So what that means is that if a client is booked for a mandatory appointment, doesn't phone us in advance and phones us a couple of days after with, you know, something that's come up, we have the ability to say, OK. But at the moment, we don't have that ability because what we have to do is notify DWP because someone hasn't kept up with their job seekers agreement.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just before I bring in Joan and then John, could I ask Kate or Alistair or Tanya on the general discussion, that, other than the specific question there, are there any comments you want to make on that?
Yeah, I was going to get back to Mr. Finlay's comment about the cold calling, just to clarify so it's not taken out of context. When we are delivering cold calling to our customers, it's a training exercise, so they have an advisor with them. They're not actually calling an employer. They're actually calling another member of staff who's pretending to be an employer. It's a learning experience. That's what I was trying to explain, so just so you didn't take that out of context. But I was going to say something about sanctions. Obviously, Shaw Trust are keen to avoid undue stress and financial hardship on the people that we are supporting. And Shaw Trust advocate an early warning system in relation to sanctions. So it's about prevention, it's about communication and treating people like human beings. And I think if you give people forewarning that behaviours might result in something, again, it is about a learning experience.
Okay.
There's one other area of improvement, which is about the assessment process. And I think it's about joining up that assessment process and sharing information more widely, because sometimes I think the feedback has been that individuals have been sanctioned where their circumstances haven't been taken into consideration, principally because information has not necessarily passed from one organisation or agency to another. For example, someone's mental health issue or someone's childcare responsibilities. And so that the circumstances of the individual need to be taken into consideration. But it's about that information flow.
Okay, thank you. Joan?
Yes,
Joan.
Thank you very much. Yes, just to go back to these figures from the disability charity Inclusion Scotland, they have provided us with figures on this issue of moving disabled people in out of worklessness via the work programme. Up to the 31st of March 2014, while there were over 14,000 employment support allowance work programme job outcomes, there were 41,721 ESA work-related activity sanctions during that period. Thus, a disabled person on the work programme was three times as likely to be sanctioned as they were to find a job. That's absolutely shameful, isn't it?
I think it sanctions the responsibility of DWP, so maybe better
question. I'm actually struggling to see how you can unlink these two things, Mr. Young. You know, a disabled people in the work program, person in the work programme is three times as likely to be sanctioned as to find a job. That's a terrible reflection on the work programme.
I think our responsibility in the work programme is to move them into work. We'd have no responsibility over the sanction regime.
Mr. De Pellette, do you agree with that?
Well, we are responsible for, as Nick says, providing employment support for individuals. We will mandate people to attend appointments on occasion. It doesn't happen all the time, but it happens for a significant number of individuals when they are kind of referred through. We want people to attend. If people don't attend, we are required. We have no choice but to notify DWP, who will then commence the process of identifying whether someone had good cause for not attending or not. It's not in our interest for people not to attend appointments. It's absolutely not in our interest.
Just for the sake of the public that don't know these things, people on ESA tend to be, you know, they'll have some barrier to employment, a disability or an illness. So these people are vulnerable. And yet they're three times more likely to be sanctioned as they are to be found a job on your programmes. I mean, that suggests that your programmes, to me, you know, are just, they're not working at all. And those that are found a job are found a job, or they find a job under this terrible threat, because we've taken a lot of evidence as a committee on the effect that sanctions and the threat of sanctions have on people. People's mental health as well, because a lot of these people have mental health issues. You seem completely unmoved, if you don't mind my saying so.
I'm absolutely not unmoved at all. The plight and the personal circumstances of our customers is incredibly important to us. And as Paul mentioned, and I'll reiterate, you know, our responsibility is to move someone into work in order to try and help them have a better life, essentially. We are not responsible for issuing sanctions, so I'll just reiterate that again. It's a responsibility that lies elsewhere.
Okay, you're unmoved by that in terms of what the disability charity said. If I could move on to what One Parent Families Scotland have said about the work programme. Many single parent experiences of the work programme are very negative, both in terms of how well the scheme supports them to find sustainable work which fits in with their caring responsibilities, and in relation to the attitudes of staff. Often staff appear to completely disregard the fact that parents have responsibilities for children and make completely unreasonable demands of them. Are you moved by that at all, Mr. Young?
Yeah, I'm always moved when we receive feedback of that sort, and particularly myself as someone who has worked across the lone parent sector for quite a considerable amount of time. I used to run our lone parent contracts for Working Links, and I'm very aware of the success that we've had with lone parents and the very positive impact that it has on their lives and their children's lives. So I'd be very interested to speak to One Parent Families, who have been one of our partners throughout our journey with lone parents, and get some further details on that feedback. Mm.
Do you support sanctions? Would you support? Do you support the principle of sanctions? Yes.
I support the principle of conditionality.
To what extent do you support sanctions on one-parent families?
I didn't say that I supported sanctions on one-parent families. I said I support the principle of conditionality.
But that's sure that we're talking about semantics here. You know, sanctions are conditionality. It's just what degree you're talking about. So do you support this? The withdrawal of income from single parent families.
Again, it's not a decision for me to make. We support the principle of conditionality as a way of encouraging active participation.
And that, does that include single parents?
Single parents have long had conditionality attached to their benefits regime.
But do you support that?
I think it's had a really positive impact over the number of
you
years that
it's been.
You do support
it, right? Do you support it for disabled people?
Again, some disabled people will have conditionality attached to their benefits regime. Some will be participating in programmes as a voluntary.
And you
voluntary.
Support that?
I support the rule of conditionality.
Okay,
believe that
thanks
it has,
very much.
Tanya, in a nut.
Hi, I was just going to comment on your questions as it raised some thoughts. It certainly flags up the importance that there needs to be a specialist disability programme aimed and targeted at individuals who need specialised support. And certainly from Shaw Trust's perspective, we certainly endorse, it needs to be a needs-led assessment at the benefit stage, identifying those barriers, whether it's childcare, debt management or housing, and actually focus that support on those particular issues. And possibly mainstream delivery doesn't always address that.
OK, thank you. Jones, or anything else?
That's fine, thanks.
OK, John and then Claire.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. My first question is just to pick up on something that Kate Still said earlier from Employment Support Scotland in relation to, and you mentioned this in your submission as well, about how information is shared, particularly with Job Centre Plus. And I think you referenced it's not particularly good just now, could be improved. Could you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, I think that part of the issue and part of the sanctioning of lone parents and the disabled and young people disproportionately is sometimes related to the fact that information about individual circumstances is not necessarily passed on in a timely manner to the provider. So there can be lengthy gaps in some of that information being processed or that information being provided. And I think that ERSA is really calling for better initial assessment of individuals' circumstances, skills, attributes, their ambitions, and that, you know, working around that, you can then put in place earlier a more supportive package. Sometimes some of the issues do not get revealed to the providers or the first line staff until after several weeks, so that, you know, sometimes there's a difficulty in getting that holistic package in place.
So it can be shared, but it's just being delayed, or is the issue that the permission of the job seeker is required in some cases? Or what
the permission would obviously be required, yeah. But I think that if we worked towards a system where there was information which the individual owned and agreed to share with providers, then we could actually design a much better system. If people know that their information is being shared so that the right package of support can be put in place, then I think they would be supportive of that.
And do the providers have a view on the sharing of information?
Yeah, I think it's a broader issue, I think, than just around the issue of conditionality and sanctions. Before people come to the work programme, they'll have been unemployed for at least a year. During that period, they'll have been supported by Job Centre Plus. They may well have been supported by Skills Development Scotland and by local authorities and third sector organisations. And within that whole process, they may well have to answer the same question on a number of different occasions. And I think there's a tendency sometimes to kind of conflate the need to protect personal information with the effective delivery of services to individuals. And, you know, one of the people you hear evidence from shortly did some work for the Scottish Government on employability and skills. And one of the kind of the key findings for that from that was that we spend quite a lot of money on employment and skills in Scotland, but it's not always easy to determine what we get for it. And that's partly down to having multiple different agencies all essentially running different systems and not in a position where they either feel comfortable or confident sharing that for the betterment of individuals.
Okay. My next question was about employment support relative to people pursuing a self-employment route, which was an issue which came up last week, and also thinking Employment Support Scotland's submission, there was some reference to a disincentive between people using self-employment as a possible option towards employment. Can you expand a bit on that in terms of what you said, Employment Support Scotland's submission, in terms of looking at self-employment as an option more so than it is now relative to the support you get through the Employment Support Scheme?
Yeah, I think it's just to reiterate that we think that self-employment should be a valid option, and it's not always easy for the individual to get that level of support. So again, it's about that joined up nature of support so that self-employment becomes a realistic option for individuals.
And what are the barriers? So, I mean, can you just expand a bit more on what those?
I just think that sometimes in the submission, I don't think I know the detail, too much of the detail, right, of it, but
I think One of the challenges we have, and it did come up last week, I think, with one of the participants that was giving evidence, was this issue of being able to access support at certain times and then not at others, being on a particular programme and essentially being perhaps too long-term unemployed to access skills provision or not being able to access something that meets the needs of an individual at a particular point in time. I think while there is a significant evidence base around what works, we need to bear in mind that going forward we won't always exactly be able to map that out, and we need to bear in mind that we shouldn't put in place disincentives that basically stop people from getting something that they need just because they happen to be in the wrong benefit at that point in time or because they've gone beyond the point where they're eligible for that. That's not about providing the right support for individuals.
Yeah, I think that's really it in terms of eligibility conditions. Sometimes we've had that with different programmes, as Paul has said, where you can access it at a particular time, but you've got it tied up in terms of the eligibility rules, how long you've got to be unemployed, and what type of business you want to do.
Okay. John? Claire?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've been listening to the discussion this morning, and the use of the customer has been used quite a lot. But is, in reality, is your customer not the DWP as service providers?
Well, we're DWP's customer, and then the individuals that access our services, we view them as our customers. That's the terminology we would use.
Okay. But they're not customers in true sense of the word, and that your responsibility lies to the DWP in what you're doing.
Responsibility to DWP is for the performance of the contract and the contractual compliance of the contract, but for our frontline staff and for our managers on a day-to-day basis, the people that come through the door are the customers.
Okay. You mentioned that you have surveys that you do of the clients, but one of the things that came through in the evidence session last week was, you know, people feeling that they had no ability to complain, to make their voice heard in the process. So can I ask you what the percentage return is for customers, we'll use that word, for your own surveys and for the independent survey that you mentioned?
So each organisation will do different things, and we've done a number of different things over the piece. I suppose, firstly, on feedback and complaints as a day-to-day thing, so over and above, you know, doing a quarterly or an annual survey, we have complaints policies very clearly kind of positioned in our offices. People get a copy of the complaints policy during their induction, and there is an independence to the complaints policy, be that if they're not satisfied with what we say, they go to an independent complaints examiner who's external to our organisation. But over and above that, we also kind of look for, evaluate and use the feedback we get. So in every office, we'll have a "you say, we did" board where people can say things like, could you get this newspaper in to look for vacancies? Could we have more workshops in this particular area available? And it's just common sense to listen to what people want and try and make sure that we deliver more of that. In terms of the surveys would be done in a number of different ways. So some of those surveys would be for clients who are in the offices searching for work, and they can log on and complete those surveys. Sometimes it would be telephone-based surveys that we'd get an independent company to do. And we also have if office managers that regularly run focus groups to try and, you know, get a little bit more qualitative information rather than just do you like this or do you like that or would you like more of, to try and dig beneath that a little bit. But the return rates are pretty reasonable, they're pretty high. I don't have have them in front of me, unfortunately.
Okay. And in terms of the, you said the current target's about 33% of the DWP for success, is that right?
The targets, yes.
One of the targets. So in terms of the 77% of people that haven't been successful, or you know, obviously there'll be a bit of variation in that because you're exceeding the target, but what follow-up is done with those people to get the feedback as to why the work programme wasn't effective for them?
So for every client that goes through the work programme and doesn't achieve a job, then there's a process that happens at the end where an exit report is completed for that individual before they're referred back to Job Centre Plus for whatever help and support they're going to get at that stage via the next stage of the Job Centre regime. Job Centre Plus would also conduct initial appointments with individuals during that period. And when we do some of our focus groups and some of our surveys, we would look at different cohorts of individuals. So one of the things we would often look at, because, you know, we need to look at the kind of the counterfactual as well, is people who are not engaging with our service, people who have got infrequent attendance, try to find out why, try to get underneath, you know, because it's, you know, it's fantastic if you get good feedback, but actually sometimes getting feedback that's a bit more balanced tells you what you're doing well and what you're not doing well, and you can try and improve upon that.
And I think you mentioned a variation of options, about 30 options that are available to people for different types of training. Are each of those 30 options individually assessed and monitored and feedback taken in those to see what's successful, what isn't?
There are 30 workshops where people can volunteer and be referred to go along. They're all voluntary, and those are mainstream workshops in the broad area of employment support, and those are delivered by our group facilitators. In addition, we have a health and wellbeing team where we've got physiotherapists and psychologists who deliver an additional suite of 12 workshops, again all voluntary, and at the end of all of those interventions we would kind of complete kind of end of course surveys where we would get people to talk about what they liked and what they didn't like and what they would do to improve it.
Okay. And does the data that you collect from these surveys of your complaints process bear any relation with the contract that you have with the DWT? Are they part of your success matrix, looking at the number of complaints, etc.?
The final stage of the complaints process is actually with the Independent Complaints Examiner, which is an agency of DWP. So one of the metrics they would report on is the number of complaints that are received and the resolution of those complaints within the timelines of the complaints policy.
Okay.
But over and above that, sorry, they would also do, as part of their audit regime, they would also come out and talk to clients that are on the programme.
Okay. One of the things that was mentioned by Jake last week that I think she found most difficult about it was the lack of privacy in the whole process. Is that something that you have taken cognizance of?
Well, it's slightly disappointed to hear that. I think, again, in all of our offices, we have, you know, at the front door on the way in, we have a clear sign saying that if you require a private room for an appointment, please ask. We also remind people of that during their initial appointments with advisors. We know that people don't always feel comfortable asking for these things, so it is something that we often, you know, ask an advisor to re-prompt people on. It has come up selectively in complaints and before where people have said that perhaps the sign wasn't obvious enough, and we've taken feedback around making sure that those are more obvious. But when I'm in our offices, as I am most days, I do see advisors sitting with clients on a one-to-one basis in private rooms, so I know it does happen. It's a bit continuing to make sure that people feel comfortable asking for that.
Okay. If I can just ask final questions about in the area of sanctions that were discussed. I think somebody mentioned if we had good cause to go back to the DWP if something happened later on. In the universal credit visits that we've done, it's become apparent that there's no flexibility for a holiday or a family event for people to take time off from their conditionality regime in that term. So we've all had examples of people being sanctioned for attending family funerals, etc., last minute emergencies and things like that. And it was also mentioned that people needed to be treated like human beings. Do you think that's treating people like human beings, not to give them any flexibility to be able to go to a family wedding or do something like that in the system? And will that cause you further problems in terms of the good cause argument?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, you know, for our advisors, as I said earlier, having someone not show up for an appointment is not a productive use of their time, and it's something that they find demotivating. So, you know, we would certainly, as long as we know about things in advance, then we are able to, within the current rules that we operate within, able to rearrange appointments, and we do that regularly. You know, we probably find that, you know, in any given day, you know, that it will probably be the case that an average of one appointment per advisor is changed for reasons that are valid, and things like people who have last minute emergencies, and we would rebook that person in for another appointment. So it's a bit consistency of service, but we do have to operate within the guidelines that are set as part of our contractual requirements, as for any organisation delivering employment support services.
Have you any comment, Ms. Young?
Yeah, I would come back on that and just to reiterate a point that's common across our industry. I think when you're able to give your frontline advisors as much autonomy as they need to do their job, then they invariably they're able to do it to the best of their effects. If I go back just slightly to some of your points around the training, yes, every training that we offer, we do an evaluation afterwards. The training scores are incredibly high, very pleased with that. Our trainers are a very, very dedicated and professional team. Overall complaints are, I think they're quite low on the work programme. It's significantly low, 1% of complaints that we have right across our 60,000 odd people that have joined. It's still too much, but it's less than 1%, significantly less than 1%.
So if less than 1% of people are complaining, but the success rate is only marginally over 33% or whatever the target is at the moment. Is that not give you, do you understand where the bulk of the people that are through the programme, why they're not successful in it then?
Yeah, we do have a huge amount of data on the challenges that individuals face and how likely they are to progress into work. Those that are not likely to progress into work, given the timeframes and given the restrictions on some of the services that they need.
Okay. I know, Neil and Christina, you wanted to come in, but this is going to eat into the session with the next panel.
Very briefly for me.
Very briefly.
The assumption within the system, I think, is that the problem of not gaining a job lies with the individual. Therefore, if we only raise their confidence, if we only get them a new suit or polish their shoes or something like that, then that's what will get them a job. You know, I think that's the wrong assumption. Is the problem not that the reason people can't access a job is that there are structural problems within our economy, and that means there's a lack of jobs in the first place. Therefore, don't you think we have to rethink this whole thing?
I think for us, when we look at the individuals on the work programme, the challenge is, although confidence is incredibly important and is a key feature of what we deliver, but when you look at things like the functional skills and functional skills levels, maths and English levels, if you look at the health concerns that individuals have, then those play a significant factor in determining whether or not someone will move into work. Ultimately, programmes do not move; they do not give someone a job. That's the privilege of businesses. Yeah. We certainly believe there are a lot of vacancies, and we're filling a lot of those vacancies with our customers, but obviously a more buoyant economy...
So is it your view that even if there was an excess of jobs in the economy, we would still require your services?
I think our services are, but will always be required, yes. People will always need support to bridge from where they are to the world of work.
Okay, Christina.
Thanks very much, Convener. The National Audit Office report dated July 2014, page 8, paragraph 17, has got I'll just read it. On average, prime contractors have reduced what they plan to spend on the hardest to help group. The support for work programmes harder to help participants is lower than those with better employment prospects. Providers' own estimates show that they plan to spend 54% less on each participant in the harder to help groups. Now, I've got a young constituent who is in that harder to help group, who was being bumped from work programme to work programme in retail outlets, which in my opinion used her labour and then chewed her out at the end of the 6 weeks or whatever. I seen an advert on a billboard and I phoned her and I said, this company's looking for staff. I gave her some advice. I should declare an interest. I was one of the founding members of the Scottish Union of Supported Employment. So I gave her some advice and she secured that job. So how much of a price tag is that individual? How much do you get for that individual if they stay in a job?
I'm not sure what customer group that individual was in.
ESA.
Right, again, there's subcategories within that.
Hard to reach person.
We wouldn't be getting paid when she got into a job. It would only be if she'd achieved success and remained in that job for a certain period of time, and then there's a payment trigger at that point.
Let's just say she does. So what's that payment trigger and how much is it?
The payment trigger, the published DWP payment trigger, I'll just go through them here. So you bear in mind that there are different categories for there are 9 different customer groups.
She's 23 years of age, so she falls within that 19 to 24-year-old age range.
Again, for ESA groups, there are different tariffs, if you want to do it that way. Okay. There's no payment when an individual moves into work. It's only when an individual remains in work for a particular set period, and then there are sustained payments thereafter. And the DWP, I've got their published stats. We get a different amount of that because we have a commercial arrangement with DWP, but DWP have got their
published
stats. So
that person stays
in
work. What's the payment you get?
It depends on the customer group. I don't know the specifics of the customer group. It varies wildly. So if we could catch up and you can let me know the customer group, then I'd be happy to provide that information.
Is it about £1,100?
For the individual, when they move in, when they remain in work for a set period of time, it varies from £1,200 up to £3,500 if you are the XIB work-related group.
So if I support that young person to stay in that job, do you think the DWP will pay me £3,500 for finding her a job?
That's a question that's probably best asked of DWP.
Well, I might just ask them, because then I'll donate it to my local food bank.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel?
Just,
Neil, we've got a panel who have been sitting patiently waiting to come in, and we really need to give them the respect of time. So can I thank you very much for your contribution. I think there are one or two things where people may want to follow up, and if you can provide some of the information asked for, then that would be very helpful. Thank you very much, and we'll now suspend the meeting to allow the next panel in. Thank you. If we could reconvene and welcome our next panel, Stephen Boyd, STUC, Bill Scott from Inclusion Scotland. I'm kind of struggling to see where everybody is, all mixed up here. Andy Hirst, Cambridge Policy Consultants, John Downey from SCVO, Pamela Smith from SLAED, Anna Ritchie-Allen from Close the Gap, Satwa Rehman from One Parent Family Scotland, and Dr. Jim McCormick from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. Do any of our new panel want to make an opening contribution, anything that they've either heard this morning or previously heard? Pamela?
Yep. I'm representing the Scottish local government sector, and I think it was interesting this morning, and I'd like to say our interest in employability is mainly because of the relationship with the well-being of our citizens, and we know that the level of the quality of life, prosperity, will be heavily influenced by the quality of employment, and we also see employment as a main route out of poverty, inequality and disadvantage. And we have witnessed a lot of our most vulnerable job seekers actually being sidelined. And it was interesting to hear the discussion and the outcomes in relation to the work programme, because in our experience, there isn't personalised provision, there isn't integrated assessment, and I think because of the parachuting in, there is a one-size-fits-all approach, and certainly local government, we welcome the consultation by Scottish Government, and we welcome the devolution of further powers. However, we also are concerned about the jagged edges around the powers that will remain reserved, and to what degree we will have the freedom and flexibility to truly design person-centred approaches, given that conditionality and sanctions will still be reserved. So we are interested in this whole debate in terms of how we can adopt a more preventative approach and how we can target the most vulnerable job seekers and give them a weighted intervention instead of creaming the most job ready in an outcome and payment by results model.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else at this stage? Rachel?
From Sam Itch's point of view, we're very keen that there remains a specialist disability employment programme, because the main barrier for people who have a mental health condition or another ESA claimant is their actual condition, so there needs to be a health-based response rather than a generic employability-based response. I think that there needs to be an evidence-based approach going forward, so some of the experience of the last 5 years demonstrates what works and what doesn't work. We know internationally that individual placement and support works very well for people with mental health problems, and we would also like an audit of the current spending so that we don't follow good money after bad as well. Okay. Going forward.
Jim?
I think we're all aware of the limitations of what's being proposed, but that shouldn't get in the way of seeing the opportunity here. And I think the opportunity in part is to reframe the purpose or the goal of these employment programmes and to be more ambitious than we've seen in the UK so far, and to go beyond sustained work as the objective, to look at earnings progression and the reduction of in-work poverty as our objective. If we change the overarching incentives in the system, we change culture and behaviour. And I think there's a big opportunity for Scotland to be amongst the best in the OECD, at least for this particular type of provision.
Okay, John Denny.
Convener. I think the key proposition that resonates with our members in our discussions over the summer around employability and welfare is around really what we might call a participation and contribution strategy. I think Jim talked about the opportunity, but it's not, as Jim says, just about getting people into paid employment, because people contribute to society in many different ways. We've got carers, volunteers, learners, activists. But I think for us, certainly, and Pamela mentioned personalisation, we need to expand the self-directedness at the heart of whatever we're doing in terms of welfare and employability. We need to start thinking about how do we give people much more choice over their own lives and what's in, based on their needs, their demand, not with, you know, a black box worked programme type approach, which actually doesn't work for anyone in the end. So I think we need to be much more personalised, think about the self-directedness, and certainly for us, I think we've got to ensure it's all embedded and connected to drugs and alcohol policy, social care, justice. There's a whole range of areas at the moment where the linkages are not as strong as they should be.
Okay, thank you. Bill, and then Anna.
Yeah, very much echo John's just we think it should be about increasing disabled people's participation in society, and that could be employment, it could also be volunteering, it could also be involvement in community groups and politics, etc. And basically, if you increase the social inclusion of disabled people, you will improve their health and well-being. And that will have knock-on benefits in the health system, in the social care system, etc. But just as a one-size-fits-all approach that everybody can go into work does not work for all disabled people. There will be some disabled people who will never be able to work, but they shouldn't be abandoned and just left to one side. There are many other things, many other ways they could contribute if they were supported to do so. Then there's another group of disabled people who could work, possibly only part-time, etc., but they should be supported to do that rather than, you know, expecting everybody to get a full-time job. So, you know, we think there's a huge opportunity here as well, you know, and as I say, bringing into alignment health and social care with employability and actually trying to use the integration of those services to deliver a new programme that supports every citizen to achieve their full self-worth.
Okay, Anna?
Yeah, we would agree and see this as an opportunity for a meaningful change in terms of women's experience of entering paid employment. We would urge the committee to take a gendered approach in its findings in recognition of the fact that current employment services contribute to the concentration of women in low-paid, undervalued occupations, which contribute to women and children's higher levels of poverty and affects their pay and progression over their lifetimes, which in turn entrenches occupational segregation and widens the gender pay gap, which has an implication for Scotland's economy as well as individual women.
Okay, Satma.
Thank you. We would like to see something that's person-led and not programme-based, which is what the current experience is of many of the single parents that we work with. And the sort of generic scattergun programmes don't work for many claimants with complex needs or those who require a more tailored response or have other caring responsibilities. Talking to the parents we work with, they'd like to see further integration of skills, employability, employment support, further education at a local level, but linked to other key supports, for example, childcare. That's one of the biggest issues that many of the families that we work with talk about, and also welfare rights and money advice. So they're getting a holistic package of support that's going to enable them to enter or re-enter employment in a way that's going to be meaningful to them. We would ask for it not to be payment by results. That works against many of us who are in the charity sector or smaller community organisations and doesn't always allow the time it takes to engage and support many of the parents that we're working with to get them to the point where they can engage meaningfully with training and further education. And that it shouldn't be prescriptive, but building the package around the person, with the person, and taking that sort of assets-based approach. And there are examples of that already in Scotland. There's a Making It Work programme that's currently being run in 5 local authority areas for single parents, supporting single parents into work. And that takes a very personalised, assets-based approach. And the interim evaluation of that the Big Lottery have commissioned are showing that it's getting the employment outcomes and significant employment outcomes.
Okay. Just before I bring Stephen in, Satwa, could I ask you, you said you didn't support payment by results. Do you support these large providers being paid irrespective of how effective they are, how good a job they do, how caring they are about the service that they provide to the people that they're working with? Do you think they should just be paid anyway?
I think it's more about looking to see how you get the partnership and the providers around the table who are going to be able to build that journey for the family. And for some of us who would be part of that, we would not be able to sustain the support that we would like to give to families if there was a payment by results model. For example, a lot of the work we do might be at the very beginning stage around engagement, which is very time-consuming and resource-intensive, but isn't going to give you an outcome that comes further along the pathway for a year, 2 years, or something like that. So if you're wanting to develop that sort of model, there are going to be likes of us who would not be able to do that on a payment-by-results basis. Mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of your question about do I think we should be handing money over without there being any outcomes of accountability, then the answer is no, I don't think that.
Okay. Stephen?
I'd like to build on the comments made by Jim, I think, stressing the scale of the opportunity that is before us, I think, as these powers are devolved. I think we should recognise that active labour market programmes is not an area that Scotland or the UK has traditionally excelled in. I think we should recognise that we have traditionally spent very little money on these programmes, although they're commonly understood to be expensive. If you look at what the UK spends compared to other European nations, it's a tiny proportion. I mean, Denmark comes close to outspending us in cash terms, never mind as a percentage of GDP. We also have a very low participation rate in terms of job seekers who are actually engaged in active labour market programmes, again, one of the lowest in the European Union. So we have to understand that, you know, we have to learn from good practice elsewhere. We have to learn also that good active labour market programmes tend to be rooted in economic circumstances, the institutions and the culture of the country. And I think it's, you know, particularly important that what we try to do in Scotland in terms of design is intimately linked to current Scottish Government activity on economic development and particularly fair work. And I think as we seek to move away, hopefully, from the work-first approach that's dominated recent UK approaches to a model that invests much more in the individual for the longer term, then I think, you know, aligning active labour market policy with the Scottish Government's fair work agenda is going to be particularly important.
Okay, could I just stick with the theme that both Jim and yourself mentioned, Stephen, about opportunity? We want to look at what future delivery would look like once additional powers are devolved and the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament has responsibility for setting up its own framework of welfare benefits. One of the things that we heard from the research that we'd asked Sheffield Hallam University to do is that the single biggest, in their opinion, the single biggest influence in getting people into work was actually an economic upturn. It's the availability of jobs. And some of you will be dealing with sections of the population, and we've heard also from others, dealing with sections of the population that are always on the margins, that find it most difficult to get into work when employment is readily available. And that becomes even more of a challenge when employment when jobs are not available. You know, we've also heard, and some of our members have talked about the pillars that should underpin a new system about dignity and respect. In terms of opportunities to refashion a social security system in a different way, what would be the values and the principles that you think we should be examining? John?
I think, convener, if you look at the paper the Scottish Government, I've got a copy here, published a few weeks ago, creating a fairer social security system, where they've got to at the moment, you know, they actually, in pages 10, 11 and 12, quote from an SCDO engagement we had with a number of our members, and I think, you know, Bill, who's here, was one of them. We had about 45 grassroots small members who are at the front line of dealing with people who have got complex needs within the social security and employability system, and we had a day with officials who were all there, and I think the reason I've reproduced it, because if you look at the principles of the social security system they're talking about here, it's based on dignity, respect, rights-based, person-centred, simple but complex. There's a complication there. Flexible, responsive, sensitive. Actually, the principles are all there, and I think that equally applies to employability. If we get the principles of how we want to operate, and I think personalisation, self-directedness is at the key of that. And I think in terms of the job market, some people will need a light touch support to get into work. Others with more complex needs will need more support. But it needs to be flexible. If you look at the moment, you know, we've been a big focus on youth unemployment, which, because the labour market is changing and because of, you know, investment that both national and local government have made in trying to reduce that, you know, that situation is easing. It's not solved by any means. But the problem is, at the moment, 25 to 43-year-olds are virtually getting no support within the current system. Scottish Government has extended our support to 29. So we need to be able to be flexible in a system where we can look at people's needs, but we can also make investment choices at different times within budgets, because that's important for both national and local government to actually have the flexibility change in terms of local labour markets. So I think, you know, all of that for me, you know, does maybe not quite answer your question, but I think the principles here, I think, for us are key.
Okay, Jim?
So a couple of principles I would suggest. One is about trust and...
Trust among programme participants is at the heart of this, so dignity and respect and how people are treated. But there's a quite important issue about public trust, you know, the wider population's trust in the system, because we all contribute to paying for these programmes, so we need to have a degree of confidence that what we invest in the future is effective. And employer trust in programmes is also critical. The last thing employers want are, you know, lots of people who are poorly matched for the vacancies that they're advertising, or conscripts who are just turning up because they've been forced to. And so that I think is a pretty important element at the heart of this. The evidence from well-designed programmes internationally, and the evidence is, you know, good, bad and ugly, but the well-designed programmes show us that you can get substantially better outcomes and you can make savings in the long term if you focus on getting, if you like, a good match between the job seeker and the vacancies that are out there. If we, as Stephen was saying, just pursue, you know, a labour force attachment model where we're chucking people at the wall until they stick, it's a very inefficient model. It costs a lot of money. It has lousy outcomes. If we take longer, as Sava was saying, it may take longer to improve basic skills, get good quality childcare in place, reduce barriers around confidence or transport or digital skills. If you take a little bit longer with some people, you get much better outcomes often. And so I'm not against payment by results. I'm just in favour of measuring results over a much longer cycle than we tend to do at the moment.
Okay. Stephen?
Yeah, I mean, I think that last point Jim made is really crucial. I mean, I've got before me a recent Eurostat survey of what works in active labour market policies. I've just used out the first sentence. It says, the primary goal of active labour market policies is to increase employment opportunities for job seekers and to improve matching between jobs and workers. Now, I think this is something that in the UK we've routinely overlooked, and it's the way that programmes in other countries are designed, that matching element is every bit as crucial as the first component of that. And I think I'd just go back, convener, to the point you made in your remarks there about the Sheffield Hallam research, which I think is really fundamental to all of this and which is very often overlooked. I think there's a tendency now that we badge as employability issues that are fundamentally about economic development. And I have sat in seminars over the last few years at the Scotland office a couple of times at the height of the recession when we were discussing employability. And I was, well, what's the point really of discussing employability as the labour market is tanking all around you? I mean, it's about, you know, the debate that day should be about, you know, how do we generate sufficient demand to improve employment opportunities for everybody. So, I mean, I think as we have this very important discussion today, we have to understand the demarcation lines, I think, around about what employability programmes are ever going to achieve and what is the role of wider economic development policy.
Neil?
Yeah, we just had that issue raised in the last, well, I raised the issue in the last session about, you know, the assumption within the system that the problems were the individual, not with structural problems within the economy. You know, I think also Jim's paper was there's a telling point with it. It's a point I've made repeatedly since coming on this committee, and he sums it up well. It says the evidence suggests devolution may carry risks as well as rewards, especially when local delivery diverges from policy goals. There is no automatic relationship between decentralisation in employment and skills services and more effective integrated delivery or improved experience. Achieving these gains depends on managerial, fiscal and delivery capacity of lower tiers of government and lower delivery partnerships. So if we have a situation where we devolve the work programme, let's say we have devolve it to local authorities or to partners down the line, and yet local authorities are being starved of funds, then it doesn't follow necessarily that just because we devolve it, it's going to be better. So we have to have that in mind when we think about how we're going to design any system, and also the principles that apply and the values that are behind that system.
Okay, Bill?
Yeah, just to go back to what you were saying about how employability is affected by the economic cycle. In the long boom between 1998 and 2008, the rate of employment amongst disabled people in Scotland rose from 39% to 49%. Right? Now, that's steady progress. You know, that it's not fantastic, because it should have been higher, and it shouldn't have been starting from so low a base, but there was steady progress throughout that long boom. Since the recession, employment amongst disabled people fell to as low as 41% in Scotland, and it's only now recovering to about 43, 44%, but it's still well below what it was before the start of the recession. And yet the employment rate of non-disabled people has recovered to about, it's recovered. There's more part-time work, there's more self-employment. I agree, Stephen, but you know, about 80% are in some form of employment of the non-disabled population. So the non-disabled population have largely got back into jobs, lower paid, part-time, etc. But the disabled part of the population have largely been excluded from that return to work that's happened. And so there is a need for services that are tailored and match people to the jobs, because what we found and what Glasgow Centre for Inclusive Living, SAMH, everybody that's been involved in working with disabled people to get them into jobs, is if we work with the disabled person to identify the barriers and we work with the employer to overcome those barriers, we can succeed at a very, very high level of success. It's more expensive to do it, but it results in long-term benefits for the individual and for the employers, and it builds up that relationship of trust that's absolutely essential to make it work. Because going back to it, if you get the wrong employee, none of the barriers addressed, they'll fail. The employer won't take another referral from you, and that's the end of that chance of that firm, that small employer, medium-sized employer, being opened up to other disabled people coming in later. So I think it's very, very important that the support's tailored and that there's matching goes on that really genuinely identifies barriers, as I say, for both the potential employee and for the employer, and works with both of them to overcome them.
Okay. My apologies, Rachel. I didn't welcome you at the start of the session. You were originally listed to come in the other panel, and you're now in this one. So welcome to Rachel Stewart from SAMH. Kevin, and I know a number of others want to come in.
Thank you, convener. We talked in the previous panel about the fact that the sanctions scenario is not being devolved and will still be retained by the DWP. And One Parent Family Scotland said in their evidence, as it stands, the Scotland Bill will devolve responsibility for the work programme to the Scottish Government whilst maintaining the current sanctioning regime, which underpins both referrals to and the policing of the work programme by the DWP. This would seriously restrict Parliament's opportunities to develop effective employability services. I wonder if Satwa could comment some more on that, and I wonder if we could hear from others if they think that that it is illogical to devolve the work programme but not let us deal with the sanctioning regime here and let the DWP come in as it wishes in that regard.
I mean, ideally, during the Smith Commission process, we argued, and our submission was based on that what we would want would be coherence across the system in terms of policy and delivery. So we would want to see the policy as well as the work programme being devolved. That's not what's happened, as we know. So we are left with this disconnect between the policy and the practice. It does concern us. We have significant numbers of cases of parents who are with work programme providers or subcontractors who are being referred for sanctions on the basis of not being able to do something. I had two cases emailed to me last night where the parents involved had explained why they were unable to undertake a certain activity as part of their work programme and then found themselves sanctioned. And there'd also been no communication between the provider and the job centre for the reasons that were given. So the job centre weren't informed of the reasons why they'd said that they couldn't do it. I'm not going to go into details or name names, but this is what we want. This is what we see an opportunity to try to improve. Yes, the sanctions regime is still with us. Yes, conditionality is still with us. Ideally, we would like it not to be, but what we're hoping is that we can develop a more coherent programme, link it more closely to support, and try to minimise the referrals that would be coming from the work programme providers or whatever we call it when it's devolved and we're responsible for it. Minimise the referrals for the sanctions.
We could set up the most coherent programme with all of the linkages that John talked about earlier in terms of housing and justice and all of the rest of it. But at the end of the day, we still will not have a say on whether somebody faces a sanction or not. And that level of incoherence, illogicality, seems to me to be plain daft. And the fact that we're getting, yet again, incomplete powers just doesn't make any sense to me. Do you feel the same way?
Well, that's what we argued for. We argued for there to be coherence. We argued in our submission for the conditionality and sanctions regime also to be devolved, so the policy and Job Centre Plus, so we could actually have control and create that coherence. But what we're hearing very strongly from the families we're working with, or the question we're being asked is, it's not as, you know, we spoke to you about and we wanted, but what can you do to make it the best that it can be for us? And that really is the starting point that we're now having to move forward from. How can we make the best of what we've got?
You want to come in on that?
Yes, just to come in on that. I don't know if you had the chance to hear the earlier session where I actually quoted from your excellent briefing paper. But in terms of sanctions and these big companies that are delivering these employability services, when I questioned them about your paper and the suffering of single-parent families, they basically told me that the sanctions were nothing to do with them, that it was a completely separate thing. Is that your experience of these companies?
Can I just get my phone to quote these two case studies, if you don't mind, just because they came through last night and I don't want to get the wordings wrong of them, because I do think it's important, because actually in both cases it was the provider who threatened the sanction. It wasn't a referral made and then a sanction. It was the provider who threatened the sanction. So I'm not naming names, but we have a client who said he couldn't attend a training group because he felt unwell and would be going to his GP. He was then informed by the DWP he was sanctioned as he did not attend a work-focused activity and did not inform the trainer. It turned out that the training provider didn't tell the DWP that he'd phoned them.
Can I ask you what the training provider was? Who the training provider was?
I would want to go back and verify it, but I'm very happy to write to you with that information.
Okay, thanks very much.
Just to clarify,
Was the sanction issued by the DWP because the provider didn't supply the information, or was the sanction determined by the provider?
Well, it seems that the provider would have made the referral to say this person didn't attend this course, but they hadn't explained, or the DWP claimed it wasn't aware of the reason, the fact that
the sanction was levied by the DWP.
The sanction is levied by the DWP, that's right.
The failure is in the provider not supplying the proper information to the DWP.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the second one is a client who was threatened with a sanction if she didn't attend a computer course, even though she'd informed them she could only sit for 30 minutes due to arthritis, and the computer course was for 2 hours. She was informed if she didn't attend, she would be sanctioned. So the feeling amongst the caseworkers, the staff that work with One Parent Family Scotland, is that the providers appear to be acting as if they have the right to give out sanctions. And there's a concern about the information they give to the DWP, who then enforce a sanction without taking into account the client's view of the situation.
Yeah,
so it's that communication I think we can improve. There are things we can hopefully do to improve that situation.
It's maybe not just the communication, it's the lack of separation between the provider and the DWP. So if the provider thinks that whatever they say will be agreed by the DWP, the DWP issue the sanction.
That's right.
So what there needs to be is a greater degree of separation in the decision-making process, and also clearly better information going to the DWP, because I think from what you're saying is that the provider themselves can't sanction, but they seem to have assumed that whatever they say, DWP will just rubber stamp, and clearly that's wrong. Anna, you want to come in then, Christina?
My point was actually, well, in terms of sanctions, my point was actually before that question. So just to quick, I don't know, it's kind of going back a bit, but I did want to agree with the points on matching and also linking an employability policy with economic development, which Stephen had mentioned, because we know that women are being funneled into low-paid, female-dominated occupations. And because of their propensity to be carers, whether for children or for sick people, older people, disabled people, we know that a lack of flexible employment means that many, many women are working below their skill level. And that underutilisation of women's skills has a significant impact on the economy. So until we address the fact that women are in the wrong jobs for their skills and experience, then that needs to be reflected in the design of new employability support.
Okay, Christina.
Thank you very much, convener. In the earlier session, I was asking some questions about the success. And John, you might have recognised some of the stuff that you had written for Third Force News, because I quoted it. And some of it was around about, you know, success. And it ties into what Bill was saying about the difference between people with disabilities and complex needs getting into employment now and maybe then. So I use some of the figures that now ESA claimants, about 4.3% of them are finding a job, but in 2011 it was 7.1%. And pre-2011, and I do have to declare an interest here because I did manage a project that was about employability for people with learning disabilities, mental health issues, so and I was also a founding member of the Scottish Union of Supported Employment, so a wee bit, you know, a background there as well. What I did see was some of the work programmes that are being delivered now were being delivered at that time by not-for-profit organisations or third sector organisations, who seem to do some of that more holistic approach, who then seem to have a better success rate. And certainly the project that I manage it, in one really good year, we had a 71% success rate, which was something the whole team were proud of. My question essentially is pre-2011 to 2011 till now, what's the difference? Because I believe that many of you will now be subcontracted by the two private companies who are making a profit on this, to do some of this. And I know that a lot of the WISE group workers that I worked with are now working for some of these companies. That's why they've got some very, very good staff, in my opinion, in some of these private companies. And it was really to get a feeling from some of the organisations around the table
on the difference between pre-2011 and post-2011. And on the back of that, and the National Audit Committee's report suggests that providers are spending 54% less on the hardest to employ groups, so the people with multiple disabilities and more challenges, and whether that's something you recognise as part of your everyday work.
Okay, Andy and then John.
A simple reason might be that's when the discounts cut into the contracts. All contracts had first 2 years at full price, and then every provider negotiated a discount on their prices as on a declining scale. So there's less money around in the last 3 years.
Okay, John.
If we look at the performance of the work programme post 2011, and I'll contrast that with Community Job Scotland, which obviously SCBO runs, and that's a consortium of 585 third sector organisations. Stephen made the point earlier on about the amount we invest. Community Job Scotland costs more than the work programme, but actually our positive outcomes in the last evaluation by Glasgow University was 66%, 54% into jobs. Others higher are further education. The work programme's currently sitting, although I'm sure the primes present it slightly differently, around 24%. So the work programme's patently not working. And I think Andy's made a good point that the discounting, that kind of discounting can't be allowed to influence whatever we do with the money in the next thing, because actually the financial settlement has actually been skewed because of the large discounts by the primes. And I guess to Stephen's point about investing in people. But they have been cherry picking for the last few years, those who can easily get into jobs and actually leaving off. But I think in general there's not that many third sector organisations compared to the number who work in employability and all the wraparound services, advice for people who are actually working with the primes in Scotland, because most people took a decision not to work with them because of their approach.
Okay. Rachel, you wanted to come in on something else, so just come in on this and I'll come back to you.
I'll come in on this. I was going to suggest, following on from the cherry-picking remark from John, in terms of the change following the incapacity benefit reassessments, much more people with long-term conditions would have been pushed through post-2011, so the demographic within the work programme would have changed. There would have been far more people with long-term conditions, so as the generalist approach to those people with conditions that they weren't able to support into work, their success rates, that could be one of the reasons why it fell.
34% cut as well in the investment in those people would be an added...
Well, absolutely,
yeah,
you know.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, Pamela, you wanted to come in?
Yeah, I was just going to pick up on what John said. A lot of the poorer results has been the failure of the providers of work programme to connect locally and to align with local services. And I know most of local government does not interact or deliver on the work programme. Therefore, we haven't managed to get a whole person approach, because a lot of those in receipt of the work programme will also be receiving other local government support, social rented housing, being engaged with social work, community justice service, etc. So there is an opportunity lost there, and to some degree the work programme has been delivered in a silo locally, and those participants are being disadvantaged from the other local support infrastructure. And again, it was a principled decision, certainly within my own authority in Falkirk, that we were not going to shore up the profits of private providers by delivering their outcomes for things they were then paid to deliver. And I think that has been to the disadvantage of the more vulnerable job seekers, unfortunately.
Okay. Now, Rachel, you wanted to come in with something else.
It was in regard to the sanctions and about how important the relationship is between the employability advisor and the client. And if you have one person, if you're trying to get that individual back to work and you're applying sanctions to them, the relationship's going to break down. And that's going to just set back any attempts to get that person into work. As a subcontractor and work choice, obviously participation is voluntary, so sanctions don't get applied, which is why we said in our submission that we felt that individuals with disabilities or long-term conditions, or even short-term conditions, if they're in receipt of ESA, should be put through a voluntary programme to remove the threat of sanctions on the basis of their their condition, but also just to, it's been much more successful in placing those individuals in work. You do have better relationships between advisors and clients.
Okay, Jim?
Just briefly on the sanctions point, then a wider point, if I may. I think any way you look at this, I mean, we can have different views on what should be devolved or decentralised and when and how, but this is a, you know, incoherence at the heart of the settlement. It's probably unsustainable too, which doesn't give us any comfort in the short term. I think it's unsustainable because of the divided accountabilities that providers will face, let alone the kind of disruption to relationships at the front line that Rachel has talked about. So I think it's unsustainable. The other point about conditionality is, in the UK, we have defined conditionality in a really weird way compared to other countries. We have defined it only in terms of the penalties that apply if someone is perceived to have not met their responsibilities, for example, under the claimant commitment. In other countries, notably Scandinavia, but Netherlands, Germany, Austria too, conditionality is seen more positively. It's about the incentives and the carrots, if you like, that we are willing to invest in you if you meet the conditions. So it's about childcare guarantees, it's about training guarantees, it's about if you lose your job, here's the investment to get the next job. So we shouldn't run away from conditionality and limit its definition to sanctions, because that would be stepping outside the internationally understood way of going about active labour market policy. And a final kind of forward-looking point, I think we should probably spend more of our time in the coming months and years, you know, trying to spot what does best look like, what does what works look like, what's the opportunity for Scotland. The Scottish Government is developing, for the first time in a long time, a labour market strategy for Scotland. Amen, it's long overdue. But what we do in this space has to fit with what's happening, especially at the bottom end of the jobs market in Scotland. In-work poverty, casualisation, the revolving door of people being in and out of work frequently. We need to have something in this space that isn't just for unemployed people, but is about people who are in very insecure positions in the jobs market being able to progress. And I think we should have a programme that's good enough that invites people in on a voluntary basis, not just helps people who have no choice about being there or not. Okay. That's a kind of forward-looking point.
Bill?
Luckily, I was just about to make that point about the disconnect. The worry that we have is that the Scottish Government and the other stakeholder partners in Scotland, the local authorities, health service, etc., could adopt a programme much more like Work Choice than the Work Programme, which is a voluntary-based programme where people put themselves forward for the help and then get tailored support. But the problem is that the job centres will be driving people into that programme and making it non-voluntary, which could destroy the trust basis that you need. And if you look again at the sanctions, I've not got the figures in front of me, but as far as I believe, there are about 60-odd percent of sanctions are overturned, you know, the referrals, either at review or appeal. And that means a lot of the initial decisions are just plain wrong and based on inadequate information, which is going back to some of the examples that SATVAC provided, that decisions are being made which penalise people potentially for very long periods based on completely inadequate information. And, you know, if we need to move away from trying to drive people into work to a much more carrot-focused approach where we actually say, here's the help that we can provide, and if you take those steps, we will reward you for taking those steps, and that will result in much better outcomes, particularly for those people that face immense barriers getting into the job market, not because of their willingness to work, but because of the employer's unwillingness to employ them.
Okay, Andy and then Claire.
I was invited here presumably because I did the work last year on mapping the employability investment in Scotland, but I'm also a trustee of an organisation down south called Papworth Trust, and we deliver the work programme under contract to a prime. So there are two things I want to bring into this discussion. First and foremost, at the end of the process of the research we undertook, I'm convinced Scotland needs to take a step around identifying income as the basis of the objective of welfare to work, not jobs. Jobs have never been more meaningless. You know, 25 years ago when I first started doing this, someone got a job, it meant something. And you could reliably assume that they would move from that job to a better job. I don't think you can do that anymore. We know nothing about how well people stick work after 6 months. It's not a very long period. Would that make a difference on a CV to an employer in the next employment? I'm not sure it would these days. So progression in the labour market is a real challenge, and it goes alongside a lack of jobs in the first place. That said, the other thing I learned from the review was that we don't know anything like as much as we think we know about programme performance. We cannot draw a blueprint for a programme. What should the ratio be between advisers and clients? We don't know. Evidence doesn't tell us that. There's nothing in the research about that. We've done work on that, but it never got published. DWP said it was the kind of thing you shouldn't look at. But it's what you will find if you go to the front line of any project or programme. It's about the amount of time an advisor can spend with an individual. All the evidence I've ever looked at over 25 years, I can find you a very good, whatever design you come up with, I can find you a very good supportive evaluation, and I can find you a very bad destructive evaluation for the very same design. It's not what you do, it's the way you do it. So culture and understanding and working with clients is essential. But we don't evaluate that. It's not in the research. I visited our local office. It happens to be Cambridge. Cambridge has a lot of jobs. But as an organisation, Papworth Trust, we achieved double the ESA rate for flow clients. 13% outcomes. That sustained jobs. Twice the national rate. And that's from the start of the contract to today. The first 2 years of the contract, I don't mind sharing with you, our trust lost money. We now earn a surplus. We don't do as well with the long-term ESA clients because there isn't sufficient money and time in the work programme. We need more time. We have things like an allotment in one centre, cultural and arts-based activities in another. The real issue is not necessarily training people, but giving them activities that socialise them and bring them up to standard. The one thing I know from talking to frontline workers in our own organisation about sanctions is most of the clients they work with would get sanctioned if they were under the orbit of DWP on a day, or Job Centre Plus on a daily basis. It's not in our interest to do that. We try bend over backwards, but they would not want to lose the ability to have someone sanctioned if they did not feel they were pulling their weight.
Okay, Claire and then Neil.
I don't know how many of you were able to see the discussion earlier on, but I find it a bit strange that the way the contracts are organised, that they talk about people in the work programme as customers, and Jim used another word earlier on, conscripts, and I just want to know, do the people you represent feel that customers are conscripts?
Conscripts. Yeah. That's how to say think of the work programme. Unfortunately, it's had very, very few positive outcomes. There's certainly more support for work choice. And I would support what you said, though. It depends who's providing it and how they're doing it. Are really important issues.
I was just going to say, many of the parents we work with would probably see themselves as conscripts. However, when I've been going around the country speaking to groups of parents, there's a very mixed experience, and so much of it seems to boil down to who it is you see. And it goes back to the point that you were making just earlier on. You know, I was in Dundee speaking to some parents, and I was asking them about their experience with the job centre. And one of them said, I've got a really good advisor. They understand me. They understand my issues. They know what my own health issues are. They know what my concerns for my daughter are. They'll look at something and say, no, I don't think that's right for you. Talking to the other parent who sees another advisor in the same job centre, totally different experience. And I think that does go back to the issue of culture. I think there's an issue around training. this issue about the advisers themselves understanding what the regulations are, what's in guidance, what flexibilities they can and can't apply. And there's the fact that the system, the sort of the culture of the organisation doesn't allow them to do that necessarily in the way that they would want to. It was a conversation we were having earlier. If the culture of the organisation is such that actually this is a default position, we want to see the number of people you're sanctioning, that works against them being able to provide the more supportive service that we spoke about, that you spoke about at Papa's Trust. Well, I mean, we ourselves do some work with Working Links, running a Marks and Starts programme, but we ensure all the parents who come on there are there voluntarily, and we're able to provide them with the support and the understanding. And actually, many of them report a very positive experience and sustained employment outcomes. So even within the current system, there are those tiny pockets of good practice, but they're pockets. What we want is coherence, and what we want is something where that's the standard that everyone would expect, wherever they are.
Okay, and we certainly heard that last week, that the quality of the individual advisor or the attitude of the individual advisor was critical. Neil and then Joan.
Just very briefly, Chair. I think I'm glad we've got into the culture thing, because we seem to have created a horrible culture around all of this, where it's where there is no trust, or trust seems very limited, and disrespect seems to be a word that keeps cropping up. And I think, actually, if we're honest with each other, we saw that this morning in our questioning of some of the members of the previous panel, because I think all of us distrusted in some way what we were being told. That was certainly the impression that I got from the question of the panel, and I certainly was one of them. So that we seem to have created a whole atmosphere around this whole thing that revolves around distrust and a lack of respect, and I don't know how we are going to overcome that, but it has to be fundamental to how we change the system, that we have one that's based on some kind of mutual respect for people who are claimants within the system. I despise using the word customer, and crucially, the folk who are in the front line and having to deliver the services, because it must be bloody miserable for them at times as well.
Okay, Joan.
Yeah, it's a different point, actually. It's about how we deliver the services once we've got these powers, and we have touched on the pros and cons of localism, which was in Jim's paper, and that was touched on earlier and has been touched on in other discussions. And what I want to talk about is that in our briefings, one of the things that comes across about employability services is that they're incredibly complex, the way that they're delivered, and there's lots of different people delivering them. And it has also been said that because of that, you know, like the actual amount of money, how much of the money that's put into employability services actually gets to the people that need it to deliver these quality services. So what I'm interested in your views on is how do we design services that meet the needs and the very varied individual needs of people, but we get rid of that complexity also so that more of the money actually gets to the people that need it. Is there a way through that? Can we design a more streamlined system in Scotland, or do we need to keep it complex?
Sure. The local government had submitted a position statement to Scottish Government on that very point, and we're looking at local by default, national by agreement. We recognise we need a national framework, we need national standards, but we would very much want to exploit the Community Empowerment Bill and look at how we get local planning in place and local resourcing, and taking the services much closer to the job seekers and the vulnerable clients. But I think more than that, we have to look at a much more joined up approach, and we need to look at an all government approach at Scottish Government level and local government level, because there will be less money in the system, and the money that we currently have, I think we have to make work better for us. So in terms of the people in receipt of housing, tenancy support, social work support, community development support, etc. We need to look at how we can better align that locally, and I think it has to be tailored to individual circumstances. I think we definitely have to move away from the one-size-fits-all, but we have to look at some national principles and some national performance, so there is some cohesion. But I think, as importantly, we want to look at how we deliver on our social policy. So we are looking at community benefits and procurement, reserve contracts, supporting businesses, supporting employment. How do we join all that up in a more coherent fashion, including economic development, the Scottish Business Pledge? All that plays into the one picture, but currently they're all operating in silos. So it might not necessarily mean more money, but it means how we actually approach it and how more effective we can be in decluttering a lot of the bureaucracy and a lot of the landscape. Because you're absolutely right, there are too many structures, too many programmes, and it is very complex and confusing. And I think we have to look at dismantling that and simplifying the whole process and approach.
Okay, John and then Jim.
I think, if you start with the premise we're putting people at the heart of this system, then the key thing from the start there, Joan, is actually high-quality early assessment of people, their needs, and what they're capable of, their capabilities as well. With some young people, a young graduate doesn't need that much support or help, some with much more complex needs. And I think we can, I would agree with Pamela, we need a system that's got a national approach but can actually work within local areas. I mean, I'll refer back to Community Jobs Scotland. We run that as a national. We allocate jobs in every local authority area. But at the same time, the number of jobs we have for each year, the target, we have a number allocated to young care leavers. So we work with Who Cares Scotland to support those young people. We work with Inclusion Scotland in our disability interns programme. And actually, we niche it within that, because some people will be on it for 6 months. Others, young disabled people, maybe longer-term conditions, will be on it for 12 months. So you can build up the kind of personalised approach and support that if people need longer, they can work on. But I think for us, putting people at the heart of it, our submission to the Scottish Government in terms of employability said, you know, focusing the whole thing on tackling inequality. But I think Andy's point about income gets to the wider point that Stephen and Jim were making about actually where are we going with the economy. So I think that's a really interesting point.
You have lots of niche programmes, you can argue that they're meeting people's needs, that they're complex, different needs. But if you have lots of different programmes, that's lots of different people administering those programmes, which takes money away from the people that you're trying to benefit in the first place. Is that a price worth paying? Is there any way around that?
Well, I think it depends on the connection. I mean, for example, in Community Jobs Scotland, we've got a memorandum of understanding with local authorities. We actually work quite closely with the DWP. We've had a DWP secondee in to help it make it easier to get people into jobs through the job centres. We've actually got the DWP to agree that actually with their advisors that we can start working with young people in prison who are going to be coming out. So what we've got, Joan, you have a national framework programme where actually, and the majority of young people go through the national programme, and actually they get the same kind of service, they get a job and an opportunity. But I think the other thing that we see is, what are your objectives, what outcomes do you want? Community Jobs Scotland does two things. One, it gives young people an opportunity, a job. It also builds capacity in the third sector. So for the money that we're getting a double hit on that. So I think you need to be very clear on what you want. But you are going to have a lot of different niche programmes, because we've got a lot of different people with complex needs within the system.
Bill?
I think John's question gets to the heart of this, actually, and it depends who we're talking about, because John's right, there are participants in the system who could get by with less being spent on them, and others who absolutely need more time, money, expertise spent on them. So if we're talking about people who are stuck in low pay, have poor qualifications, are going to have very poor prospects over the next decade, I think the international evidence is, I mean, without wanting to do violence to the evidence, but certainly from some of the best examples, we do need more specialism and more diversity of provision. That doesn't mean that every local authority has to run its own programme, but it does mean that for people with particular predictable barriers, they will sink in mainstream standard programmes and they will keep cycling round and round. So we have to get the balance right between national standards and frameworks, a sufficient degree of localism, a sufficient degree of specialisation. And because this is new territory in many ways for us, we need to be testing, learning and adapting. And I would favour, the thing we really need to understand here is about commissioning skills, commissioning capacity. Where does that best sit geographically in terms of sectors? We may not know all the answers, so we should be testing and evaluating. A final point I would just make about really about rights and responsibilities and power in this system. I mean, John's right about self-directedness. I mean, the evidence here is kind of promising rather than proven, but there are good examples from Australia and the Netherlands and elsewhere of job seekers with certain characteristics being given a pot of money with guidance and support to navigate what is often a complex landscape, but to find the best type of provision that suits their needs. And sometimes you have to spend quite a bit more than we do at the moment on those participants, but we're much more likely to get good outcomes and therefore to make savings, which is quite important to make this financially viable. We're more likely to do that if we take that proportionate approach to people's needs in the system.
Okay. Bill, Andy and then Satwat.
I think one of the problems is going to be that the complexity is going to increase, because there are still going to be DWP delivered programmes and there are also going to be the Scottish programme, whatever it is. And therefore the potential for disconnect will increase. And that's bad for people looking for work, and it's also bad for sometimes for the people that are helping them look for work, because they need to know about all of those individual niche programmes that we've been talking about. And I think there is still a place for niche provision, but we need to do better on the big programmes as well. It's not acceptable, I don't think, that, for example, gender, women are being pushed into low-paid jobs rather than the higher-paid, higher-skilled jobs that they could be going into. And there's been a concentration on numbers rather than overcoming inequality. And that particularly disadvantages disabled people, because they tend to be left to one side. That's why, when I was saying earlier, employment rate in non-disabled people, not the employment rate generally, the employment rate in non-disabled people is returned more or less to the same level. But because more disabled people are unemployed, the employment rate hasn't recovered completely. So if we did concentrate on overcoming those inequalities within the mainstream programme so that they were judged not only on numbers, but on what are the gender outcomes, what are the outcomes for disabled people? What are the outcomes for young people within those programmes in terms of reducing long-term unemployment amongst that age group? Then I think you begin to see programmes that are more fit for purpose. So that it's not really just design, but it's actually about what outcomes do you want to achieve through this? That then takes you back to how do we design the programme to achieve those outcomes.
Okay. Andy, so
A couple of points following up from what Jim was saying. One of the reasons we don't know how cost-effective programmes are is that the work programme and many others rely on free services, and we don't include those in the calculations. I know that from our own delivery with Papworth Trust. We go after everything that's free and then pay for what we can afford thereafter. That is not included, and yet it's vital. How do we manage that and deal with the overhead problem or the fragmentation issue? Not many programmes have addressed that very well. One I remember, 2003, 2004, Human Resource Commission in New York, contracted providers in 24 boroughs with a mix of primes and voluntary agencies, but paid centrally for drug and alcohol support, mental health support, housing and other advisory services, because they are paid for services. They work with volume, not with one-off contracts are very expensive if that's the only client you're going to get from the work program contractor for the next 3 months. You can't afford to sustain a service. So that's one way of looking at this, of where collectively you can use your purchasing power to buy big on services that on a per head basis could be small if they have scale. I don't know whether it ultimately worked in New York. I wasn't allowed to go back there by DWP, so unfortunately. The other point, following on from what Jim was saying about the investment in individuals, the Dutch have a system now where they ask 29 questions at the start of a claim. And on the basis of those 29 questions, they can predict with 70% accuracy who will not get a job for 12 months. Because they're not just about characteristics, it's about attitudes. And I think that is the basis for a needs assessment, for understanding who it is you really need to invest in earlier and who it is you can save money on, because if you don't do that, this is going to be too expensive.
Okay. Satwat, Stephen, and then Kevin.
Okay. Thank you. I think one of the reasons why we have such a sort of complex landscape when it comes to employability is because what was said earlier, a lot of the sort of mainstream programs weren't meeting the needs of groups who had additional needs or particular groups, and many of us, myself included, went out and got bits of money to put together training programs either for BME communities, for women, for people with disabilities, and so you've ended up with this really diverse landscape, some of which is delivering very well, other bits of it which aren't. And I think it also recognises the complexity of people's lives, and there's something about actually how do we make it so that people feel comfortable going and being able to ask for support from the system that we're providing, as opposed to going to their local community group where they've got relationships and they know people, and then they think about how they're going to put on some sort of employment training for them, which is how many of these things have grown up in that sort of developmental way. But I think at the heart of anything that we design have to be something around the quality of the experience for the individual who's coming into it, and equality in terms of access, in terms of experience, and trying to achieve equality of outcomes. And that's where the need for the tailored and the specialist programs comes in, because that's not recognizing everybody's not starting at the same point. And we have to level that, that playing field. I also think there's something around how we get the balance right between rights and responsibilities. I mean, I feel at the moment with the families that we're working with, they'll come to one of our programs because there's an agreement, there's a trust, there's a culture that's been spoken about earlier where they will give time, they will attend, but they get something back that's a value to them and that means something to them and that they can see is going to help them and is assisting them. Whereas within the mainstream programs, through the work program, what we're seeing is all the responsibilities are on the individual to do lots of things through the claimant commitment, but that their rights have been constantly eroded. So whatever we try to design, I feel we have to see how we can get that balance back and that mutual respect and that understanding. And I think one of the ways we can look to see how we can save some money in the system is to see how we can integrate with other support services. Like, for example, many of us will probably have pots of money attached to our programs to support with childcare and with other things. And yet what we're wanting to do is look to see how we develop a childcare infrastructure that supports the child, has the best outcomes for the child, provides continuity of care and experience for the child, and enables the parent to be able to go into training feeling confident that their child is not going to be suffering and hasn't just been parked somewhere. So there's a way of how we can look to bring together the sort of support services and the various bits of funding there are for that to create greater coherence in the system.
Okay. Stephen, and then Kevin.
I just wanted to make a very general point about complexity and costs. And one thing that's always intrigued and frustrated me is that active labour market programmes always seem to be judged on a different scale to other public policy interventions when it comes to admin costs, and particularly in deadweight costs, i.e. those costs accrued in achieving outcomes that would have been achieved anyway. Now, whenever we propose a new active labour market intervention to government at any level, we immediately get potential deadweight costs flung back in our face. Now, it's reasonable there should be a discussion round about the extent of deadweight in any programme, but you look across the gamut of public policy and there are programmes been run at various levels of government where the deadweight costs are about 100%. The classic current example would be the patent box. Now, why is deadweight always the first thing that we discuss in active labour market policy, where it's ignored in big other strands of public policy making. And I think if, you know, if we're ready to make the very general point about what we spend in the UK in active labour market interventions compared to other countries, and it's been very low. And I think we just have to live with the fact that any effective programme is going to have an element of deadweight costs, and that admin costs will increase every time we try to provide the very necessary support to particular client groups. Now, we just have to live with that, I think, and if we always tangle ourselves in knots about the potential costs and all of this, then people will go without the very vital assistance they need. And I think, you know, one point leading on from that is, you know, reading your research yesterday that seems to suggest that IT is extremely limited in what it can deliver as part of the employability process. You know, there's been a number of programmes in various countries that have tried to introduce a much more online element to this kind of thing. The outcomes do not appear to be very good. Now, that is the one perhaps obvious way some people might think the cost will be reduced. Well, I suspect that will not be the case. So again, we have to understand that as long as people are at the centre of delivering decent services, then the cost will be, well, reducing those costs will be very limited.
Okay, Kevin.
Convener, we've been talking about complexities, but in evidence that we've taken previously, sometimes the most simplistic thing is the easiest way to get somebody into work. And Bill and others have talked about access to work. We heard it in evidence last week from the support worker of the lass who didn't feel that she could come in front of the committee. Some have said that it's almost a hidden programme in some regards, and yet it has results. Simple and delivers, and yet it's one of the areas that's not being devolved either. And again, you know, there seems to be an inconsistency in this. And maybe there are lessons from programmes like that, and I'm sure there are others that are being delivered, whether that be locally or nationally, which have probably been formulated because, for once, government has listened to people. And that, I think, should be one of our first things that we do, audit and see what works. Because we'll often find, I think, that the simplistic thing works much better than some of the more complex.
Okay, thank you. I'm aware of the time pressing on. Is there anything that our panel, any members of our panel, would wish to say in conclusion before we draw the session to a close?
I think Sam H is very keen for a much more early intervention and integrated approach going forward, whether that's referral pathways into employment from GPs or having a much more tailored approach through community mental health teams with individual placement and support. We know one size doesn't fit all, so we want to ensure that the 50% of individuals who receive Employment and Support Alliance who have a mental health problem get the best opportunity going forward to getting into work or progressing towards work.
Thank you. Jim, and then Bill. Well, did you want? Yeah.
I'll go after Bill.
Just a very brief point. I very much echo what Rachel said. We think that the lack of flexibility in terms of, you know, the 12 months before you can get into the programme is a real hindrance, because there's a lot of disabled people who are being assessed out of being classed as a disabled person and placed on Job Seekers Alliance that will need earlier intervention. And also we're concerned about labour market churning, where people remain in low paid work in and out of it all their lives. And again, you'll know one point where you can intervene to address those issues, increase their skills, and maybe give them a chance to higher paid work rather than the low paid work that they're used to. And that again particularly impacts on disabled people, because they're likely to earn less in the first place.
Okay, thank you. Jim?
Just on putting ourselves in a position where we can actually work out what is effective for Scotland. So the importance of data sharing protocols between Scottish Government, DWP, HMRC, so we can link properly the programmes, interventions we design in Scotland with not just job outcomes, but as we were saying earlier, you know, wage levels and progression. To be able to have more information about that will be really important. And a final point would be about accountability and transparency. Whoever ends up delivering support in Scotland in future, in whichever sector, we need to make sure that there are clear scrutiny accountability guidelines that providers have the same requirement to share information, the same audit responsibilities, and that ultimately participants have rights to switch provider, rights to appeal, and so forth. We need to make sure that all that is taken care of if we're to drive a system forward.
Okay. Any other of the panel? No. Well, listen, thank you very much for a fascinating session. There's been some hugely interesting, challenging suggestions made. And I think, to be honest, the main thing that I've taken from it, notwithstanding some of the very specific and technical suggestions that have been made, are actually the comments at the beginning that while there are challenges, while there are problems, what we have ahead of us actually affords us an opportunity. And the question is how we seize that opportunity. And I've got no doubt that people like yourselves and the organisations that you represent are going to be critical in making sure that that opportunity is delivered to its full potential. So thank you very much. And with that, we'll draw the public session to a close. Thank you.